Good evening. You're watching NewsX with me, Gauri Dibedi. Ahead of phase 3 of Lok Sabha elections, which will happen on the 23rd of April, we at NewsX have been bringing you telling data, sharp insights through the daily, as well as our weekly polls and surveys. Today, we bring to you results of the fifth snap poll conducted by NewsX and Polstrat. This, of course, as I said, is ahead of the third Lok Sabha phase, which will take place on the 23rd of April, where over 115 seats will be contested on. We ask people what they think of the Election Commission notices. Remember, there have been notices dime and dozen because there have been so many violations by our netas across party lines. The issue of EVMs, somehow, year after year, election after election, it continues to dominate headlines. We ask people about that and also about identity politics. Priyanka Gandhi Vadra and her her recent entry, of course, into Congress. How could that change equations for Congress and, of course, for Lok Sabha as well? We bring to you the pulse of the people. Let's, in fact, rope in my colleague Devika Chopra as well, who's going to tell us the result highlights of this survey.
Absolutely, Gauri. 10 important questions that matter. And the first one, let's address the first one for now. We ask, do you support the Election Commission's decision to ban or bar leaders from hate speeches? That's a very clear question and a very clear verdict. 73.14% of our respondents say yes, they completely back the Election Commission on this particular decision. At the same time, 8.74% people say yes, somewhat. So a clear majority there, over 80% people really stand behind the Election Commission as far as banning netas from hate speech is concerned.
In fact, I still want to wonder who are those remaining people who feel that these netas who are making those violations should continue to speak. But that, of course, is how democracy functions. On your screen, of course, is 73% of the people who are in agreement with what the Election Commission has done. Now, let me, in fact, at this stage introduce a panelist with me here in the studio. We have Deshrata Nigam, who's a political analyst, S.K. Datta, who's a political analyst with me here in the studio, Chetan Singh as well, a political analyst. Joining us from Bengaluru is the JDS spokesperson T.R. Prasad Gowda, and we have Gopal Krishna Agarwal representing the BJP. You know, I want to take the first question to Mr. Nigam, sir. As we talk about these violations, these hate speeches that are being made again and again by these netas, it's interesting that the moment the EC deadline, which bars them from making any comment, finishes, you once again see the competition as far as polarization or the communalization is concerned. The rant is there from every neta across party lines.
You know, what I see that somebody starts a trigger and then that it becomes a chain reaction.
Okay.
And because nobody wants to be left behind so far as, you know, gathering.
Hate is concerned and not the rant
hate.
Is concerned.
No, not hate and rant has always been a part of our poll scenario. But somebody feels that if somebody, you know, says that Muslims' vote should not be, you know, divided, and then there is a counter that the counter narrative is built up.
Mm.
So people don't want that to give that advantage to anybody. So it is because of that, and then there is a spiral that becomes.
But you know, S.K. Datta, let me ask you this, that at some level, when we talk about a democracy evolving, it has to begin with netas exercising restraint. I mean, you see the kind of speeches that are being made, one wonders which is the constituency, which is the pressure group that these netas are actually catering to.
Yes, absolutely, Gauri, and this is something which is not new to Indian democracy, and it's something which is not new to India. If I would have to say hate speech at the national level, you know, like, I mean, and if I go back in history, then I guess Maut Ki Saudagar was the first hate speech at the national level, and things started from there, and things went from bad to worse. Second is, like, we also have to understand one thing, you know, and we have to really analyze one thing as to which is more harmful. Is it the action or is it the reaction? You know, like, I mean, if the action itself is so poisonous and it's so, you know, like, it's so nefarious, and if there is a counter reaction to that, you know, like, I mean, that is quite obvious that it would be a counter to that.
Gopal Krishna Agarwal, let me ask you this. Azam Khan, a man, I think, there should be much stronger punishment for a man who makes those controversial remarks. Of course, EC has to decide that. But the fact that he makes those extremely controversial remarks, he made one today also, can we expect now the BJP to also indulge in the same rant and the same hate speeches? Because, you know, as SK Datta said, action ka reaction to aur bhi bura hoga.
No, I think BJP as a party, we have been meeting daily and also deciding, discussing that those neta like who speak out of turn, we just try to ask them not to do this. And even we have asked some of the people to withdraw their controversial speeches. We ourselves also try that those individuals who are...
Have you been able to speak to UP Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath?
Are not encouraged and ultimately...
Has the party been able to speak to UP Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath?
No, we don't see any controversial. That's a wrong statement. You don't... No, we are with Mr. Yogi Adityanath. He has not spoken anything which the party considers wrong or other thing. It is where we find that those speeches or those statements which are not in line with the party thinking, or which are they may be some wrong some issues with the election commission, that the election commission is taking care of. But as a party, okay, we don't find that
you stand by UP Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath, who made that Ali Bajrang Ali
glorification
remark.
That
I have to give
taking.
A counter.
We discriminate that.
I have to give
but
TR Prasad Gora time for a counter
in
to what the BJP said. Mr. Agarwal, I'll come to you, sir. I'll come to you, sir. T.R. Prasad Gaura, respond to
no,
what Gopal Krishna Agarwal said.
No, we have Pragya Singh Thakur has withdrawn, party has said. But
it is unfortunate in the part of our co-panelist statement to hear that. It is very unfortunate. Nowadays, you know, in our country, people are, you know, just to earn the votes of the people, they are indulging in eight speeches.
Okay.
Instead of concentrating on themselves, what the progress they have done to their particular states, they are indulging in
hate speeches,
talking
yes.
hatred speeches and other things.
Absolutely.
It is very unfortunate, and this kind of speeches are very unfortunate, and I wish. At least in future coming days, let them talk about what the progress they have done to their particular states.
Okay,
let them ask the votes.
I hope at some point
no
of time EC learns
like them,
in terms of
the
process of elections is an evolving process, and maybe the kind of speeches that have been made, the rant that has been made, at some point of time there has to be greater punishment, and I'm sure that's the process of evolving as far as elections is concerned. Chetan Singh, I'll come to you, but I want to quickly get in the next important question that we asked our respondents. And Devika, tell us, what exactly is it and what's the survey highlights?
Absolutely, Gauri. The next question that we put out to the people was which party, according to them, really needs to be blamed for the politicization of the armed forces. Now, the majority of the people here, 38.51%, voted for the Congress, but the BJP is not far behind, just 10 percentage points there, with 28.80% people voting for the BJP. So we can really see that the majority of the people here, our respondents, feel that it's either the Congress or the BJP that needs to be blamed for the politicization of the armed forces.
All right. In fact, let me ask this to Chetan Singh. Mr. Singh, and I want to also, in fact, bring in Sumit Peer into this broadcast, joining us on a Skype connection. But Chetan Singh, let me ask you this. I remember when the strike took place, after the Pulwama attack, that Balakot strike took place, it was interesting how the first set of commentary that came in from the opposition ranks was about, give us proof. And a lot of people said that is when the entire downward spiral of politicization of the entire strike and henceforth larger issue of armed forces began. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, you see, post-strike and, pre-strike and post-Pulwama, when entire opposition came together and they have said that whatever government is going to take this step, we are going to be with government. So we should not forget that the entire country was standing with one agenda, that India must respond. And everybody said in one tone, one music, that we must respond and we will be standing by with the government. But when the government has taken this step, so they just wanted to understand. And later on, the party spokesperson themselves of different opposition have themselves made it very much clear from the party side that nobody need the proof. Whatever has happened, we believe government since there was a press conference. First. Second, utmost important, the first question which you have asked, election commission plays a very vital role out here to conduct the poll in this country, the one of the biggest democracy in the world. When election commission is weak, what's going to happen? This kind of hate speeches will continue going to happen. You mentioned that the moment this time frame get over, again the person comes up with the speech. We have seen it today only, and I'm sure like who with, whom you are referring to, and this is certainly going to increase, is going to grow. The magnitude will grow in a manifold manner, and the ripple effect will be there till the seventh poll.
Let's talk about the politicization as well. Yes, SK Datta, go ahead, then I'm going to get Sumit Peer as well.
Just 5 minutes, 5 seconds actually. You know, today I just heard that Sidhu was saying about the Honorable Prime Minister that he's a blood-sucking leech and the Modi government is a blood-sucking leech. Is it something so sweet? And is it something so magnanimous? You know, like before you point fingers on the others, you have to see for yourself as to what actually you are doing. Now, if someone is reacting to that leech comment, you know, like, I mean, the reaction is unjustified. The action is absolutely justified. This is ridiculous, actually. You know, like, I mean, if the reaction is horrible and if the reaction is counterproductive, the action is horrendous then.
You know, but like, the point is, it's a downward spiral. It's the race to bottom. That's what it is. You know, it's a race to the bottom when you talk about the commentary that's coming in, SK Datta. And, you know, we can have this long chat about, you know, who is actually inciting whom. And that is something that the EC has to decide.
We should also not forget here, you know, I mean, when these kind of speeches come, the election commission taken in Supreme Court, when the Supreme Court has taken it very straight to the election commission, then only election commission has been able to take some action.
Gopal Krishna Agarwal, let me ask you this, that when you talk about politicization of armed forces, when you say, or the survey says 38% blame the Congress, 28% also blame the BJP. Nobody can deny the fact that there have been posters, there have been banners, there have been speeches, and invoking the post-Pulwama attack, the stand that India took, and the Balakot strike is in fact bordering on seeking votes as far as armed forces is concerned.
Now, Gauri, the issue is what you call as politicization. Only discussing the armed forces or their actions or the government's action and willpower against countering terrorism and infiltration from broader from Pakistan. Is this you can call a politicization? If you cannot discuss national security, the reaction of
there
our
are posters,
valor of
there
our
are
armed
banners,
forces,
there are speeches, votes are being sought in the name of Balakot strike. Gopal Krishna Agarwal.
Yes, so what can't you, can't the government be given credit of that it has decisively acted?
That is exactly given, what the opposition charges. How can the government take credit for something that
given
the armed forces
support
did?
To the armed
that
forces
is the opposition's
to, yes,
charge.
Yes. It is the only, Gauri, the question
is the political leadership.
Yes, so we stand that we can discuss, we have to discuss whatever is the difference between the factual situations and ground realities is not politicization. The politicization is when you question the armed forces for their action. Who asked? They did not ask. They actually questioned that there is no strike. It was all wrong.
Okay.
And their opposition statement were being used.
As I said,
and
both parties are
Pakistan.
To be blamed, which is exactly
so
why
that
the survey
is the way
reflects
you politicize.
That
you
both
are acting
parties
into the
have
hands
been in
of
fact,
the Pakistan.
Okay.
So
SK,
this is
before I get
the
to
problem
you,
with
get
the country. That,
and then I'm get
but
to
I want to say is that discussing national security, discussing the reaction to the terrorism, taking strong action with a determined willpower against terrorists, and infiltration from cross-border is not politicization. If you have done something, you can discuss.
But then if the opposition
otherwise,
asks questions
the
about intel
of,
failure, then you say that everybody is an anti-national.
Is
that is also an extreme step and an extreme
agenda
position
for the
that
election?
The BJP has been taking.
Gauri, you may not agree with this statement, that those who are not with us are not antinational, but if you are questioning the government on surgical strike and if you are questioning the government on Balakot, then that is shameless politicization of the armed forces by the opposition. I ask one thing: when Mrs. Indira Gandhi had divided Pakistan into two and the elections had taken place in 1974, Mrs. Indira Gandhi had gone over to the nook and corner of the country saying that I have divided Pakistan into two and I have created... It is ultimately the political leadership of the country which gives the signal to the trigger. If the government of the day and the Prime Minister of the country
has the right to give the trigger. Let him make a point.
At the same time, Prime Minister Ji, while conducting the rallies where there are a number of people, he's saying, we will go ghar mein ghuske marenge.
Our goals are the people. Our forces are competent enough to take the decision. Sumit Peer, what would you say about the comment that was made that the first time voters vote should be in name or should be because of the armed forces and the overall Balakot strike and the decision that the government took? First time voters were told this in so many words.
To vote in favor, right? You know, let me put the things in perspective, Gauri. The first of all, you know, when we had the Balakot strike, we were possibly all on the panel, some here or other. But the thing happened at just 48 hours after the Balakot strike, none other than the second man running for the Prime Ministership of India possibly is Mr. Rahul Gandhi. He did this 21 party meeting and he gave a press conference and questioned the surgical strikes, questioned the Balakot. First, there were people like Sanjay Nirupam, which were not such a high, pedestrian leaders of Congress. They used to say comments here and there. Now, a united opposition under the leadership of none other but the number two, man running for the president from the Prime Ministership of India, the president of the biggest party comes and questions the Balakot strike.
Right. That's what I said. The political secession starts from that.
And let me tell you, and you know, the second,
All right, a quick break on the show. We'll return on the other side. There are several more questions, including whether Priyanka Gandhi Vadra should take on Prime Minister Modi in Varanasi. You don't want to miss this broadcast. We come back with what exactly our respondents have said to that and much more. Welcome back to the NewsX Polstrat snap poll that we take ahead of third phase of Lok Sabha elections. Let me rope in Devika to tell us more about what exactly did our respondents tell us. Devika.
Gauri, the next question that we pose to the people, do you think that the Modi-led NDA has done more to tackle Pakistan as compared to Manmohan-led UPA? 70% people here say yes completely and 8% say yes somewhat. So a majority of about 78% people are somewhere between being completely satisfied or somewhat satisfied with what the Modi government has done as compared to what Manmohan Singh's government had done. Let's move on now to the next question. We also then asked if they think it's a good idea for the Congress party to field Priyanka Gandhi Vadra against Prime Minister Modi in his Varanasi bastion. 54% people here say no, it's not a good idea, but at the same time a sizable chunk, 26.86%, one in four voters here almost says that yes, it might just be a good idea and a good strategy for the Congress to field Priyanka Gandhi against Modi. Let's now move on to the fifth question that we put out. We asked, according to you, should foreigners be allowed to campaign in Indian elections? And quite a clear verdict here, 73.14% people say no, absolutely not.
All right, Devika, thanks for those details as far as the survey is concerned. And, you know, let me ask this to Mr. Gowda. Mr. Gowda, I know you represent the JDS, but you're also an ally of the Congress. A lot is focused as far as Uttar Pradesh is concerned. In your assessment, do you think that Priyanka Gandhi Vadra should be taking on Prime Minister Modi head-on in Varanasi? Well, ladna hai to jab ke lado.
Of course, she has taken a wise decision to contest against Modi, Modi ji, and let the people of Varanasi decide who is the best candidate for them. Because see, in Varanasi, we have been seeing in the TVs and regarding cleaning up of Ganga River.
But it's surprising.
What Modi ji has done from last 5 years, and you people only showing in all the TVs.
Nearly 55%, 54.37 say it's a bad idea.
River. Oh, the Varanasi.
54% yeah. Said no, it's not a good idea.
Yeah, maybe to contest.
Yes.
No, it's okay. But they have taken the decision to contest. Let them contest. Let the Varanasi people will decide. But I'm talking about Modi ji. He was a contestant from last five years as a prime minister, and he is from the Varanasi constituency as MP. Hmm. But at least he has kept about 20,000 crores to clean up the Ganga River. What he has done,
Gopal Krishna Agarwal, respond to that.
And he contested.
The
people were very happy.
Gopal Krishna Agarwal, respond to that.
You see what happened there in Varanasi. Modi ji has a very strong following. There is a marked difference in how that constituency, which was reeling under the infrastructure pressure, has been transformed, whether it is the guards or the sanitation or the sewage system. Mm. Though it's one of the ancient cities in the world. Yeah, and Modi ji said that his vision is to link it to
Modi ji is talking about Swachh Bharat. Modi ji is talking about Swachh Bharat, and he is not able to clean up his own constituency where Ganga River is flowing.
He will find
not able to clean up
from
his own constituency.
How he has
bring up
to Ganga.
Swachh Bharat, that mission itself is failed.
All right, you know, as I said, this is something that the people of Varanasi will decide. S.K. Dutta, let me ask you this, that, you know, when Priyanka Gandhi
Vadra entered... No, let me finish.
Gopal Krishna Agarwal, quickly make a point, because then I have a quantum question as well. Quickly make a point.
24 crore people... No, yes. If anybody has gone to Kumbh Mela, 24 crore people will vouch that this time there was extremely cleanliness. The Ganga and Yamuna rivers were much cleaner than what it was earlier.
As I said, people of Varanasi would have to decide that.
We are committed to cleaning the Ganga. Even Priyanka Gandhi herself
went on a boat ride in the Ganga River. and has entered and taken on Uttar Pradesh with the sole responsibility of reviving Congress, you know. And I think a large part of that objective would be achieved, S.K. Datta, if she decides to take on Prime Minister Modi head on. It will re-energize the cadre. It will ensure that the organization once again is present and is revived on the grassroots level, irrespective of what the outcome may be.
Well, Gauri, the question is like, when will she plunge? She plunged into Ganges, you know, she drank the water of Ganges. It was ghar vapsi and shuddhikaran. I respect that. You know, but now she should plunge also into
Chetan
the electoral,
Singh that.
Into the electoral politics of Varanasi. Is she going to plunge
Chetan
after
Singh.
23rd of May? You know, if she wants to do, if Priyanka Vadra wants to do, she should do it now. And I was listening to the spokesperson of JDS. Let me tell him one thing. Since the time of Narasimha Rao up to Dr. Manmohan Ji, Manmohan Ji had declared Ganges as a national river, you know. 1,25,000 crore was squandered by the Congress party for cleaning of Ganga. And Ram Teri Ganga Meli Ho Gai Papiyo Ke Paap Dote Dote. It never got cleaned.
Chetan Singh.
This government has attempted to clean
Chetan
Ganga.
Singh, yes.
Undoubtedly, he is right. The government has taken a lot of initiative to clean the Ganga. But yet, we are yet to see what is
Modi
happening.
He has got the power because
we know time and again Ganga is our lifeline of this country. And whatever was expected from the government to take this step, to ensure that the 100% cleaning, 100% cleaning is going to happen till what? They said till 2018. Nothing has happened. You know, when they came in the power, 2014,
no, but
they said when it comes
Gandhi
to Priyanka Gandhi.
Not Ganga.
Priyanka
Ganga
Gandhi.
Is not the sole issue. Priyanka Gandhi,
we
Vadra
all
is the
know
issue.
In UP, Priyanka Gandhi is a much towering personality. She is one such person who has never ever criticized any opponent.
Okay.
Never ever. She has never. So therefore, you know,
she's hitting on
vote.
Prime Minister Modi. What are you saying? She's hitting on Prime Minister Modi. Are you not listening to what you're saying?
During these elections,
she's hitting on Prime Minister Modi. What are you saying? Are you not listening?
That's what a great.
Are you not listening to what she's saying? What she is saying,
you need to understand the person who are occupying the senior most chair in the opposition party. We need to understand that even the local leaders in the
don't
UP,
what she is saying, youth have got lot of faith in her, youth knows that whatever
constituency she's going to take, she's certainly going to win over.
And
yes,
even if she
because
in Varanasi,
strategies,
it is going to be a contest
in
Varanasi and the local Lilliput. That is the reality.
She will be appreciated by the UP people and everybody has got a great
appreciation doesn't matter, Chetan Singh. Votes matter. Appreciation se kuch nahi hota hai. Votes chahiye hote hai. How much of this is going to be the big issue? A quick break. I come back on the other side. We did ask the respondents the question that is Sadhvi Pragya Singh Thakur BJP's clear attempt to ride 2019 on the Hindutva plank. More on that after this break. Stay tuned. Welcome back. You're watching a very special broadcast, NewsX Polstrat survey, which tells you those issues on which elections would take place as far as third phase of Lok Sabha is concerned. And the one issue that a lot of people, Devika, are asking about BJP's Hindutva plank being very clear after ensuring that Sadhvi Pragya Singh Thakur takes on Digvijay Singh in Bhopal.
Absolutely, Gauri. That's the question that we ask, that we pose to our respondents. Do they think that the BJP is trying to push the Hindutva factor by fielding Sadhvi Pragya? And 45.31% people say yes. So that's the majority who think yes. At the same time, about over 25% people, 26.86% people say no. So 1 in 4 voters also feel that it's not really the BJP's attempt to push Hindutva as far as Sadhvi Pragya is concerned.
Absolutely. And you know, Gopal Krishna Agarwal, let me ask you this question. And then I'm getting Deshratan Nigam also on this. It's very clear and simple. When you talk about Bhopal constituency, of course, the dynamic, the demographics are very clear, but the message is loud and clear to nearby constituencies in Madhya Pradesh and a larger message to India that when you talk about BJP 2019, Ujwala wagaira sab theek hai, but core issue to Hindutva hai.
देखिए the way the elections were proceeding and the way people in the opposition tried to consolidate vote banks based on religion, whether it is for the Muslim card that they were playing or the caste card that they were playing in many places, in particularly in Wayanad and other places, and even in Uttar Pradesh. So the narration they want to set, that has to be countered. And the issue is,
this is your counter.
We want to highlight is the saffron terror, the way appeasement politics which the Congress was trying to play across for 60 years since independence.
Okay, they were trying to create a vote bank of minorities. Help us understand that she is still an accused, and, you know, to appease that vote bank,
they were trying to create a saffron terror bogey which we had to demolish.
Sadhvi Pragya Singh Thakur is an accused.
See, the law permits her to. As long she is not convicted, the law permits. The way law is permitting Rahul Gandhi and Sonia Gandhi, that they are out on bail, they are not yet convicted of a crime. And
but she is accused of terror charges.
See, crime is a crime. She has not yet been convicted and held guilty. Similarly,
the gravity of crime doesn't matter?
No, unless until the person is convicted.
NIE investigation.
Let me answer. It is not about the agency which is investigating. It is about conviction. Law of the land is, unless until you are convicted.
So I understand that. That she's not convicted. As of now, she's an accused.
But you're talking about morally and ethically.
But the fact is, the optics are very clear. That, you know, under let UPA, me, this must let, have been the case, but let, BJP let me, is let very
answer,
clear.
Let me answer. You know, by bringing Sadhvi Pragya, they have, you know, busted the entire myth
yes,
of
we are very
terror.
Clear.
They brought
terror.
Out
that
the focus
terror
which
was
the Congress
was,
Congress was trying to manipulate saffron terror.
Only the court will do that.
That
BJP
finally,
can't do it.
No. BJP has brought the focus about Congress using saffron terror, manipulating and raising the false propaganda. That issue has been brought back. It is a duty of the BJP to expose Congress.
Sir, you are saying it's false propaganda, but the court has to decide it.
Well, that finally
the court will say whether it's false propaganda or not.
Let me tell you, saffron Mecca.
TV studios, no. We cannot be participating on that.
Let me tell you, Mecca Masjid, they have said these people
nobody
are not
blasted,
involved.
Yes.
Nobody blasted.
Yeah,
not,
yeah.
These people were not involved. Somebody else was involved. We know that investigation, certain people who were arrested were allowed to go to Pakistan. I can name them also. But the fact remains, end of the day, a party who uses the concept of a saffron terror has to be
based
exposed
Nigam,
every
sir,
day.
The fact is, this is what you are saying are allegations. All this has to be proved in a court of law. It's as simple as that. Chetan
yes,
Singh,
they are not convicted. They are not convicted. Nobody is convicted. Rahul Gandhi is an accused. Rahul Gandhi is accused of corruption, cheating, fraud. Rahul Gandhi can be allowed to contest for fraud and cheating and corruption? Are you saying so?
In the moment, she has been given this kind of a...
Congress has to be exposed for saffron terror. This is the best way of exposing Congress.
What remark she's making? She's making a remark on Hemant Karkare. Hemant Karkare, who Hemant Karkare is?
So that is condemnable. I don't
think absolutely condemnable.
That I don't think
the kind of administrative experience she may be having. One, she's going to hold the topmost chair
at
of the
same
state.
Time.
What kind of welfare is she going to bring to the people?
Until you are proven guilty, you are innocent. That's as per the law. You know, the court
court has to prove the charges. Absolutely. That's one thing. Absolutely. Now let me come to the political side of it. You know, I will rather want a raw, ideology in front of a camouflaged, camouflaged nakli Hindutva, hidden in a topi with a hidden tilak inside. You know, that is what Congress is
endorsing.
Recently, you ask him for minority vote bank.
In our ancient time also.
Recently, you ask him for minority vote bank. And then you say that you are a lovely Chennai Dari. You know, I don't want that. You take 49 years to discover that you are a Sikh Dhari, you are a Hindu Dhari, you are a Gotra Dhari, you are a Chennai Dhari. You take 49 years to wake up from your slumber just before election. I prefer the original rather than the artificial.
BJP is known for confusing the thing.
Let's get it. P.R. Prasad Goda to respond to that. P.R. Prasad Goda, what do you think of BJP's strategy?
Yeah.
Gauri, can I come in after that, please?
Yes.
BJP's strategies, when they cannot deliver it, they will when BJP cannot deliver it, they will try to confuse the whole country. That is their strategy. They cannot deliver. They did not deliver all these 5 years. They have not delivered anything. And you are putting blames on others. And last five years, you have not done anything for this country.
Like a crybaby. Have they delivered?
Dr. Datta, we must not forget.
One second. I will respond to that.
Do not talk about this.
Yes.
When our state people are facing problem by looking at the people's problem, they have shed the tears. Not you are making. You are taking. It has a campaigning spirit.
You
don't know the pain of the people. You not understand.
You are only interested. This is something like in a jungle, a mongoose
you
and a
are
cobra coming together.
Doing drama in front of the whole country.
And that's
whole
the
country knows what Modi is doing nowadays. What Modi has done for the country for
the
last 5 years. You are the dramatic people. Don't talk about this. Why they have said that? Yes.
How do you see Sadhvi Pragya Singh Thakur's candidature with a clear message to the electorate by the BJP? Jan Dhan Yojana, Mudra Scheme, Swachh Bharat, sabse hi hai, but core issue to ek hi hai.
Dekhiye, if we look at Sadhvi Pragya Thakur's entry into the politics, you have to look why Sadhvi Pragya, because there are a few people, which included Sadhvi Pragya, which were used as political pawns to create a false narrative called of Hindu terrorism, saffron terror. This was defaming the most peaceful community in the world. Now, what BJP has done?
These are sweeping statements, sir.
I'm going to slip into
a very short break, and I'm going to come back and ask the other question that a lot of opposition parties have been raising the last couple of weeks, which is that when elections are around the corner, raids seem to be happening. Agencies are just functioning as an extension of the BJP. That question and more we ask our respondents in the survey. Stay tuned. Welcome back. You're watching this very special broadcast with me, Gauri Dwivedi. Let's quickly now rope in Devika, my colleague, to tell us what some of the other survey highlights tell, especially the question that opposition has been raising, that agencies like the CBI, the ED, income tax are all being used by the BJP to target their opposition. Devika, tell us, what exactly does the survey tell us?
Absolutely, Gauri. The next question that we posed to our respondents was whether they support these poll time raids to crack down on black money and vote buying. Clearly, 68.28% people say that yes, they support this decision completely. At the same time, 12.62% people say that yes, they do support the decision, but it must be done fairly. So some caution needs to be applied here, but majority of the people really do back this poll time, these poll time raids to crack down on black money and vote buying. Let's now move on to the next question. We also asked, which of the following is the most important type of identity to you when you're voting? Now, very interestingly, 32.36% people say none of the above. So what does that entail? If we were to break it down individually, then 23.95% majority go with region, followed by 11.65% for religion. Then you come to language. 11% people say it's language, and caste is only at 6.8%. So that, of course, was the next question that we put out to our respondents. Let's now move on to the issue of EVMs. The next question that we posed was, how much do you trust EVMs? And 63% people say that they trust EVMs as much as they did before. But at the same time, 11.33% people say that there is that they trust EVMs a little less than before. So we do see the majority of the people say that they do trust EVMs as much as they did before. Let's move on now to the last question that we posed to our respondents. We asked if people trust EVMs more after the introduction of the VVPAT system. And 47.57% people say that yes, percentage say that yes, they do trust EVMs more after the introduction of the VVPAT system. But at the same time, 18.12% and 13.59% are still not sure whether they really do support or trust EVMs even after the introduction of VVPATs.
Thanks, Devika, for telling us those survey highlights. You know, Chetan Singh, let me ask you this question, that the opposition leaders the last couple of weeks have been saying the agencies have just been targeting us. They haven't been targeting the BJP at all. The latest also being Kanimoi. Remember, in Tuticorin residence, Kanimoi's residence was targeted. There was no cash that was found, but Kanimoi all along said that you should have also searched the house of the BJP candidate, Tamilsai Sundarajan, raising the larger issue that our agency is actually working like extension of BJP. But our survey says that isn't the case. How do you respond to that?
See, I mean, if you look at the supreme most agency, CBI, we have seen what has happened overnight. In the midnight only, the chief got changed. So agency has been have been under scanner out here, especially in this government. We have seen it out here again. If this kind of, during model code of conduct, if these kind of raids takes place, so it's a matter of serious concern why these raids takes place. Whenever these raids takes place, what happens? The election commission goes along with the income tax officer. If the income tax officer is not accompanied along with the election commissioners, then it is not going to be a legal aid. I'm sure Deshrajan Sahib is there here, and he would say about it. So first, second, utmost important. You know, agencies are the most respected part of this country. So one should not, if you are in power, we have seen in the Sadhvi Pragya case also, the NIA report has come up. So I mean, here it's again, you know, the kind of things are going
okay. Let me ask you this, then I'll get in Gopal Krishna Agarwal as well.
See, let me tell you, I think people are not aware, election commission appoints Indian Revenue Service officers as election observers expenditure. They are the ones who are raiding. They are under election commission. Income tax department is not independently raiding. So they are working under, and they work on specific information and tip off. If anybody, Chetan, has any information or tip off against BJP, please give it to them. They are working independently. These are election observers expenditure, called expenditure. These are IRS officers. It is their aids. It is provided under the law. They are not income tax officers independently doing it. Please understand.
You have seen in Madhya Pradesh also what has happened. So, Kamal Nath, when his house and offices were raided, this kind of protocol was not followed.
No, there is no protocol here. These are election officers.
Election officers were not engaged during that time when the raid has taken place.
These are income tax officers working under election commission.
Income tax officers, not the election commission.
They are election officers.
I think there's a lot of confusion out there.
No. You don't know. Please please find out. Please find out. They are election observers, expenditure. These IRS officers working under election commission.
I mean,
they
are the ones. This is something new which is coming out from your side.
This is
something very strange.
Gopal Krishna Agarwal, let me just give him a Gopal Krishna Agarwal. Let me just give him a minute, then I'll come to you, Eskedatta. Yes. Go ahead, make your point.
The issue is when Kanimoji was raided, I tell you, the fact is that it was raided on the instance of the election commission. It is not the Ministry of Finance or ED or CBI or Income Tax Department that conducted that raid. Some of the officers did go, but it was on the request of the election commission. The second point is whenever there is a raid or search or anything, it has to be on specific inputs. It cannot be just searched that they feel ki this opposition leader should be searched. It is not like that. There is a specific input based on that this search, etc., take place. The third thing is, the important part is that in Madhya Pradesh and other places in Karnataka, there were inputs and cash has been recovered in Tamil Nadu. So if this thing is happening, it is the opposition people like Kamal Nath who should respond.
Okay. But then, you know, Chetan saying, how do you explain why that hundreds of crores actually being seized?
Now you see, now hundreds
why
of crores
Ahmed Patel was sitting with that person
What are you saying? It's unbelievable. 650 crores has been recovered till now. Over 250 crores came from Tamil Nadu.
Well, this is what sad. Kind of this explanation? Is sad. This is abdo. This is not acceptable. No.
What is in totality,
you're going to say more than 1500 crore rupees has been seized by the election commission. Yes, this is not good at all. This is not good. But I'm talking about, you're talking about agencies. Agencies. When agencies are engaged and when they take out this kind of money, then the agree party get the time to discuss. If they have not been able to justify that cash, then only this
You know, and that's the reality. They are crying foul because all of them are chor chor mosera bhai. You know, as per the law of the country, during the model code of conduct and during the time of election, you cannot have more than 20,000 rupees in cash. In any effort, any of the contestants.
They are the IAS officers. Whenever such kind of thing takes place, he may not be knowing about it. There are chances that their designated himself would not be knowing about it.
Was it dropped from moon or was it dropped from Mars? Crores and crores of rupees, from where did it come out? And you are talking about CBI, under whose government the Honorable Supreme Court has said that CBI is a caged parrot? Under whose government? Do you remember that? It was under the government of the modern Gandhari. You know, such a comment was given. It was not under the present government as such. And in relation to
Dr.
the
Dr. Dutta, I can hear you very, very, very loudly and clearly. You need not to increase your decibel level.
In relation to the rates, you know, like, it is within the jurisdiction of the election commission. During the time of election, they have every right to send in the income tax officers to go in for reading.
But this is not an autocratic country. This is a democratic country. Where there is a constitution, is that the Supreme. In the democratic countries, Dr. Datta.
Giving 600, 700 crores.
So again, I am saying the Green Party can take plenty of time to disclose it. And if there is something wrong, the court are there to take the action against
it. And the action must be taken against those. You are siphoning of money from the government of India.
It is just whenever you are in government, you have all the right to manage the agency for your own labor. This
is the only matter of concern The major concern is that whenever some
okay, I'm going to take a quick break. I'm going to come back and ask the other big question that the survey does talk about, which is that region still is extremely important when voters cast their vote. What does it mean for the BJP's prospects in Kerala? What does it mean for a state like Karnataka? All that and more is what we're going to discuss on the other side of this break. Stay tuned. Welcome back. You're watching this very special broadcast. The one question that raises several issues in the survey that we asked is about what really is most important when voters exercise their vote, which is that they said caste is important, religion is important, region, 23.95% of them said that. And now that is something that I'm going to ask Gopal Krishna Agarwal and some of the other panelists as well, that in phase 3, there are 20 seats in Kerala that will go, 14 seats in Karnataka, besides, of course, several others. In this phase, it's going to be very important for the BJP, but also when you talk about a state like Kerala, BJP may have made inroads, yes, from a measly 5% in 2004 to 15% vote share in the last election. There has been gradual progress, but still, BJP has been seen as a party north of the Vindhyas.
No, how can you call this? We have a very strong presence in Karnataka. We have ruled that state for some period of time. Still, we have a strong presence with 17 MPs there. And we have in our NDA fold this Tamil Nadu. There was some issue.
In Tamil Nadu, we fought on 5 seats.
BJP not having sufficient number from the South India. But now it is. Yes, so now we have made a strong inroads, and there was in Kerala, we will have a very good presence. Then in Telangana also, we will have a very good...
Telangana, you're hardly to cause any dent at all.
And Karnataka...
In Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, you're hardly expected to cause much of a dent, sir. Hardly expected to cause any significant dent there. And likewise in Kerala also... Yes, it's now a triangular contest away from UDF and NDF.
Have a very strong
but
presence.
what will be the kind of impact that BJP will have remains to be seen. Subit P, respond to that, and then I'm going to get in the panelists here.
If you look at the BJP's position,
no, we will definitely have a very
definitely
good
consolidated
in South
over
India
the time.
Because
you know,
they have
if you look
seen
a few
how
years
BJP
back,
is performing
if you look
in
at,
North
if
India.
If you look a few years back and if you look at now, the things have changed. You know, there are few things which are very evident, Gauri. If you look at Prime Minister Modi coming from Gujarat to Varanasi and the Rahul Gandhi running from Delhi to Wayanad, this explains a lot of things to the people. Why Wayanad? Why Varanasi? Now, BJP, we have to take the point, it's not very strong in South yet, but it is consolidating. But if you look at the overall picture of the BJP, the acceptability
is
increasing.
As far as Kerala is concerned, most reports seem to suggest that from 12-8 last time around, the UDF and LDF, Congress is expected to do even better, much better in fact, given that Rahul Gandhi is contesting from Wayanad. As far as the optics of it, it could be a separate discussion, but it's working on ground is what many of the surveys are saying for the Congress. But you know, Deshwatan Nigam, let me bring you in here as well on the issue. As far as Kerala is concerned, as far as Karnataka is concerned, when you talk about the survey says that region matters the most. And the perception that BJP has always had is it's a North Indian party. Yes, of course, it's made inroads in the Northeast, but down South, that's the perception.
No, I think that was the perception about 10 years back. Not now, anymore back, now. The amount of consolidation which is going on, and if you look at the response that the Prime Minister is getting in rallies, the huge. Nobody is being able to match that kind of rallies in the South India. Take it Karnataka, take it Tirunanpuram, which has happened. So you are seeing, you know, a kind of a wave which is being built, and that has to be converted into seats.
Okay.
That has to be seen. And probably BJP is concentrating on four seats out there in that region. In Kerala, and where Shashi Tharoor's seat today, people are talking about that is not a cakewalk, it's in danger now.
Okay.
So, and similarly, look at Karnataka. Karnataka, there is a huge wave for BJP. Tamil Nadu, as you have gone to Chennai and seen, they have uplifted their election.
Okay.
It's a pan-India party.
All right.
Only it has to be converted into seats.
Okay.
That is what
yes, of course. That's really the democratic process. Completely out of time. As far as Kerala is concerned, there are at least four seats that the BJP fancies its chances. Thiruvananthapuram is one, Palakkad is another, Pattaniattam is another one that is there, and several others as well that the BJP feels it really has a good chance to be able to make inroads, and not just inroads. It has about 14% vote share. Actually convert that into getting a seat down south. All eyes now on what happens in the third phase. 23rd of April, 115 seats would go to polls. We remain to, of course, all that and more is what we're going to find out on the 23rd of May. With that, it's a wrap on this very special broadcast. Thanks for watching.